Hey everyone, I'm Jerry James Stone, and I'm super thrilled because I finally got to talk to someone I've been trying to talk to for a very long time. The one thing that's been good about this pandemic is everyone's trapped at home, and the people that I've been trying to talk to have nothing else to do. Okay, they have other things to do, but they've actually been able to like make time to talk to me, so I've been very thankful. I've done a handful of interviews. I've interviewed Valerie Bertinelli, talked to Mike Madrid from The Lincoln Project, and now I'm talking to Susan Eisenberg, the voice actress of Wonder Woman for the Justice League animated TV show. One of my favorite shows. I've binge watched it so many times. So hey, here comes the video, here comes the interview, let's get to it. Susan, I'm so excited. We've been talking about this for a while and you're here. We get to chat.
I'm here. And not only am I here, I'm so relieved that I don't have to cook because I am not a cook. And when you suggested this, I'm like, that sounds great. And then you're like, yeah, and I'll just do the cooking and then we can just talk. And I'm like, yeah. Oh my God, you're like my favorite person. You cook and you love Wonder Woman.
Right? I mean, like, what else is there?
Nothing. Especially now.
Yeah, I know. Well, literally. Yeah, I know. On one hand, that's sort of been a benefit of the pandemic is everyone's sort of stuck at home, so it's easier to interview people when I want to do these. I recently just did one with Valerie Bertinelli. We also had been talking about it for a couple years. And, you know, finally she's like, oh, I'm stuck at home. I can't go anywhere. Let's do it, you know? So I'm also stuck at home.
I feel so sad. I feel so sad for her. You know, for her son, and that's just the saddest thing.
Yeah, I know. It's weird because we just kind of were talking about her ex-husband a little bit during the, not much, just a little bit, because, you know, her and her son had this little Twitter battle about some onion rings that she had burned. I don't know if you saw that or not, but basically she had made these frozen onion rings and burnt them, and her son like took a video and tweeted it out, and he was like, she's won an Emmy for a cooking show and here's her onion rings, you know? And so they kind of were going back and forth, kind of jabbing each other. And we were sort of talking about that and talking about Eddie and stuff. And it's just like, oh my gosh, so sad. It's, you know, heartbreaking.
Heartbreaking. And, you know, it just says so much about her that they had this beautiful relationship, despite a divorce, they were family. And, you know, you just, even though I've never met her, I'm of that age that I grew up with her. And I have such affection for her, and I always will, even though, again, never met her. But there are just certain people in show business that you know are good, you know, like the good ones, and good-hearted. And she's just one of those people.
Yeah, she's super sweet and just really nice. And like, you know, we kind of connect. It's funny, you know, even though we're both in food, we kind of connected over the current political state, how we kind of connected on Twitter, you know, just chatting with her, DMing with her. She just seems super, super sweet. And, you know, she's like, when this is all over, like, let's get together and cook. And I'm like, yes, of course, that would be amazing. So, yeah.
Indeed. That would be amazing. Yeah. Yeah.
She is super sweet. But
I will never say that to you because I don't cook. So I will never be saying like, hey, let's get together. You know, I wish I were Jennifer Garner. I wish I were like, I make it look so easy. And, you know, it's so casual, but I'm just not that person.
Yeah, but you're Wonder Woman. That's okay.
Well, ish.
I mean, you know, for all intents and purposes, right?
Okay, all right. For the purpose of this interview, yes, I am.
So let's talk a little bit about kind of like, you know, your history and voice work and just kind of like, you know, some of the characters that you voiced and like, I don't really know any voice actors, to be honest. And I'm kind of curious what that process is like, how you bring a character to life. And I'm mostly curious about this because I think I've even sent you some of the artwork for the comic book that I'm working on, which is almost ready, by the way, which I would love to send you a copy when it's ready.
Okay, please.
You know, I'm thinking about those things like animation and these other things, and like, how do you bring that character to life? Like, what's that development process like?
That really stems from being an actor, you know, rather than just, you know, the voice. If you put the actor into that, it's like any character, you know, you look at it in a script, on the page, in a book, whatever, and that's what you work with, you know, who is this character? And hopefully you have a director like you would with any project as an actor. And I was lucky enough to have Andrea Romano as my director. Yeah, I mean, it really is just how am I going to approach this character? And then finding the voice obviously can take some time, unless you're really lucky and it's right there immediately. But it's just unlocking your imagination and letting it kind of carry you into this world, especially with video games, because you're just kind of alone in a booth. And sometimes you don't even get the script in advance because everything's so hush hush. So you're just like, okay, let me pretend I'm here. You know, like Themyscira, like I know Themyscira. Like I feel like it's like my part-time home. So like I can conjure that up in my mind really easily. And that's what you need to do. You need to use your creativity, like with what you do. I mean, it's very creative in that regard.
When you were kind of building out the voice for Wonder Woman, was that one that just kind of came to you, or was it challenging, or what was that process like?
I would love to say that it was really challenging and I worked so hard, but the truth is it came very naturally to me, which is just my luck that it just felt natural to say the words in the script. And when I went to audition, for the callback, you know, it wasn't pushed for me. I didn't have to push to get there. Sometimes you have to do that. And sometimes it takes a while, but I didn't have that feeling with her. The regal came really naturally. The strength part of her, the warrior part of her, I did have to work on that a little bit more. And that was the one I would lose more often than the regal.
Okay.
The regal just felt, it was just, you know, it was like being able to read Shakespeare. It's such a gift to be able to perform that. And so I was lucky that I could call that up real quick. The grunts and the power and the strengths and the kicking and all of that I had to work on a little bit.
Okay.
Make sure that she was an Amazon. You know, Andrea would always say, like, she's an Amazon, you know, enough with the nice voice. Just come on, like, you have to kick some ass here. And she would get me pumped up in that way. You know, because she's Wonder Woman for extra.
She's Wonder Woman. Now, were you, like, did you have any sort of attachment to the character before you even auditioned a voice for her? Was there any sort of, or did you kind of get consumed by it from being her?
You know, I didn't have an emotional attachment to the character. I obviously knew the character, having grown up when I did, and I certainly knew Linda Carter, because that's who I grew up with. I mean, Linda was Wonder Woman to me, and she still is in many ways. That was the attachment, but it wasn't an emotional attachment, because I didn't grow up reading comic books or watching cartoons other than like Scooby and Archie. My passion really was like my daytime soaps. Yeah, I mean, I have three older sisters, so I grew up watching Dark Shadows and All My Children and Another World, Ryan's Hope. So that was my passion. And then later, because I got the job and because it felt important to know what was going on within, you know, this universe that I knew very little about, I tried to educate myself. I'm still educating myself. I mean, there's so much.
Yeah.
So much to take in with this stuff, and the fans know it all and they get it, and you're just like, okay, I'm just trying to catch up. So it's been a learning curve, but I try all the time to just kind of figure it out.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking, I mean, at least with Wonder Woman, you're talking almost 80 years of content and reboots and, you know, retcons of stories, and you know, you have fanatics who've like know most of the content. I mean, I don't know if there's any way you can fully catch up, you know. I think that
And all the origin stories and who's her mother and how is she created, and you know, the 52 series, and you know, everything changes. And so my idea of her really is mostly from the Justice League, you know, because that was my education. So, and my introduction. So that's what I keep with me all the time. You know, whatever other project I do, I always have that Diana with me.
Do you have any fun anecdotes from voicing that over three seasons, I believe is the total, right? Like there was three seasons of it?
There were five seasons total. There were, so there were two of Justice League and then Justice League Unlimited.
Right, Unlimited, yes.
You know, it was all good. I mean, that's the thing. It was all good because you got to be part of something that turned out to be this extraordinary experience. Like in the moment, you don't know that you're in it. You know, it's great. But especially as an outsider to that world, I didn't know how big it was to be working with Dwayne McDuffie, to be working with Bruce Timm. I wasn't one of those people who were, oh my God, it's Bruce Timm, it's Andrea Romano, it's Dwayne, it's Dan Berkowitz, it's And, you know, I mean, Rich Fogel, all these masters, I didn't know who they were.
Right.
It was all exciting in that regard. And then, of course, you know, you'd walk in and there'd be all these incredible actors and celebrities, and you just kept pinching yourself that there was Ed Asner over there playing Granny Goodness. And, you know, there's Ephraim Zimbalist, and there's, I mean, it was just like a who's who, Alfred Molina. There was just everybody, Mark Hamill, everybody who was asked.
You almost want him to play Joker on the big screen because his Joker is so good, you know?
Yep. And, you know, unfortunately, we didn't, I think we did work together, but it was like, it was, you know, I would love to work with him now that I know him, yeah. Now that he knows me, and now that we have a friendship, I would love to work with him. I would love to do something with Kevin and George and Joker and you know, and Lex and, you know, I mean, everyone knows what I would like to do of the Justice League reunion, but.
Oh my God, I want that to happen.
Oh my God, so would I.
Do
yes.
you think that there's a chance of it? Like, how do you feel about it?
Well, I'm one of those optimists and I'm one of those hopeful people. So I always believe that there's a chance. I don't think that we're on the radar of Warner Brothers. I don't think that that's something that they're putting energy into. But I believe in the fans. I believe in that energy and that power to create something just because we're all invested in right. it. And I want it to happen. So you never know.
Yeah.
Young Justice came back after it was canceled. And
yes,
people got the Snyder cut, which, you know, I'm not gonna go into those waters. but, you know, people got that. And, you know, I think it's great when the fans, you know, ask for something and they get it from the powers that be, even if the powers that be weren't even thinking about it.
Yeah.
So again, I don't think they're thinking about us. I don't think that we're on their radar, but you know, it would be extraordinary to reunite everybody. And I think yeah. the fans would absolutely love it.
Sometimes too, I think it's just a matter of having space between, you know, between like the release stuff. Like now we're having, you know, a new Matrix movie come out after how long or whatever. We're having all these kind of reboots and stuff, and sometimes just having that breathing room. But I also think that, you know, with DC too, they're just trying to figure out everything right now. I feel like they're trying to catch up to Marvel as far as the movie bases go. They were putting all their content on the DC Universe app, and now it's all moving over to HBO Max, and they're just trying to even figure out where their content's going to live and, you know, all those sorts of things. So I think that kind of gets in the way, like you're kind of saying, it's maybe not on the radar because they're trying to work through all these other things.
Well, you know, our projects, we're not really, we're Warner Brothers. So it's Warner Brothers who I don't think is, you know, focused on us. Because they're yeah. focused on other things. The thing I would say about DC and Warner Brothers is that the one thing we know they did brilliantly and better than anybody is the animated universe.
Yes.
And I think they did that superbly. And I think that because we're part of that, to me, it's like lead with, you know, what works, and we work.
Yeah.
So that's been an argument of mine all along, you know, like there's this massive audience there that digs us already and they're clamoring for it. And so why not do a one-off movie that just yeah. gets us all together and see how it does. And if it doesn't do well, it would do really well, but if it didn't, then okay. But anyway, it's, I'm sure people are tired of me talking about it because I'm just such a big JL reunion fanatic at this point. But I'm, you know, I feel like a cheerleader. I think it's important.
No, I don't think anyone's tired of me talking about it. I think that we definitely, as the fans, we all want. I mean, the storytelling on that show just got so good. You know, it was yeah. just like, you know, kind of when they went from like that arc of like having like full seasonal arc stories that kind of plot lines. I mean, they were just so well done. And I remember
yeah.
hearing an interview with Bruce Timm about the first kind of Wonder Woman centric one in the early days, like when they did the, yeah. Like when they went to Themyscira with the,
yeah.
The magician, I can't remember his name right now. But he like stole all the pieces and she had to go mm-hmm. do that one. And just how he was like, it's Wonder Woman. So we have to do a really great job, you know? And they did, they just, you know, they did such a wonderful job with those characters and the storytelling that I think a movie would perform so well, you know, so it's.
And everybody on that show, you know, every character, whether it was Hawkgirl or Green Lantern or Flash, you know, everybody was understood. You know, it wasn't just the Trinity. It was everybody, you know, really was well-defined. And, you know, somebody said what they could do a, like an episode each for each character. So 7 episodes, you know, like a mini series of 7 episodes. And, you know, like there's so much potential. I guess that's my point. That's been my point from the beginning, is there's so much potential with these characters. And, you know, and I think with everything being so crappy right now, and I think that nostalgia and comfort food, something you know about, I'm sure, I think that they play an even bigger part in our lives. You know, people are going to bed to Mary Tyler Moore episodes.
Yeah.
And because it's comforting in a scary world. And I think that the Justice League, for so many people, I know it was, because I've been told by the fans, their comfort food, it's their nostalgia, it's their childhoods. And I think that there would be something wonderful about revisiting that for people.
Well, I'm just going to go a bit further, even say, I not only want a JL reunion, but I really want a Wonder Woman animated series. I feel like we've had Superman, we've had a couple of Superman ones over the, you know, if you look at, like, you know, going back like 50, 60 years, there's been a lot of Superman cartoons. Had a lot of Batman stuff, Batman animated series, you know, Brave and the Bold, Batman. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you happened to, you didn't voice the Wonder Woman on Brave and the Bold, did you?
No.
Okay. Did you happen to see those episodes at all?
You know what? I saw some of them, because they're just iconic, and I like to look at what people are doing and what the stories are. So, you know, Superman, the animated series with Tim, you know, I try to visit all of it. Frankly,
yeah, I would definitely check out the Wonder Woman episodes. Are fun. They even play like the 70s Linda Carter theme song in
it.
Like,
yes, just yes, so I saw fun. That.
But I would love a Wonder Woman animated series, because I feel like, I mean, the one thing that we've seen, and I have to kind of give DC a little bit of right here, because, you know, I've been to a lot of Comic Cons where the panel say, like, oh, you know, the Wonder Woman animated movie didn't do as well, so that's why they've only made 2 Wonder Woman animated movies compared to all the other Superman and Batman stuff. And I'm a huge Batman fan too, but I'm like, we get it. Batman's popular, but there's this, all these other characters, not just Wonder Woman, but all these other wonderful characters that you guys could explore. But I think, you know, we saw like the Gal Gadot movie do so well that clearly there's a space for an animated Wonder Woman show in the same vein as like Batman, the animated series. And that would be my dream. You voicing it.
Really?
Wonder Woman TV series. I'll just put that out in the universe. I'll tag Bruce Timm on this when we...
It won't help you to tag Bruce Timm, because it's not on social media. It's such a drag.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, when the Wonder Woman movie, the Gal's movie, the feature came out, you know, people asked me a lot about, you know, was I excited for the movie? And that's like an easy answer, of course. But mostly I was excited for the fans. For the people who had been waiting decades for a Wonder Woman movie. And, you know, I think, like you said, it's not about not wanting Batman or Superman or Harley Quinn or all these other wonderful characters to have their day in the sun. They're all entitled. But I think that she specifically has been denied and for whatever the reasons. And I think that can be rectified now. I'm not sure the numbers on the animated movies. I'm not privy to that stuff. So I don't know how well they did or, you know, didn't do, but there are so many stories out there. And and there are all these wonderful storytellers. That's the thing. Like, and there's this whole new generation, the writer for Justice League versus the Fatal Five, Eric Carrasco. Eric grew up on the Justice League. You know, when I walked in to record my part, you know, I thought I could just, you know, and he would fall over. I mean, because he grew up with our show, and now he's writing and I'm reading his words, and they're beautiful words. And so it's like come full circle in so many ways. And I think that they're the ones that are like, yeah, let's do an animated series. Let's do a video game. Let's do all this. And again, selfishly, would I love to be a part of it? Of course. But with any project that involves Wonder Woman, I just want her to get her days in the sun, because I really feel like she's been held back. And, you know, we love Superman. We love Batman. Everyone knows.
Right.
I have a soft spot for Batman. Hashtag WonderBat. But, you know, come on. Like, it's time.
100%. Like, you know, I mean, a lot of the narrative, and I think this is just like baked in sexism, like 100% baked in sexism. But a lot of the narrative has been like, oh, you know, female superheroes don't perform, they don't sell or whatever. And I clearly saw that is not true with the Wonder Woman movie.
Right.
You know, I know a lot of the times it's based on action figures too. And so it's like, oh, you have to sell like the male action figures because that's one that the little boys are buying. But, you know, I feel like there's definitely an opportunity for that stuff. And it's funny too, because even though like I grew up watching the Super Friends, you're now my Wonder Woman voice. So like, even like when I go back and watch like Super Friend episodes just for fun, I'm like, that's not Wonder Woman, you know, cause it's like, I'm just so used to your Justice League voice that anytime it's someone else, I feel a little betrayed. You know, I'm like, what are you doing? You know, it's like, you know, so it's, I mean, I think that you did bring such a great kind of, you know, that you had that regal part, but like, it was a really great character. I mean, I think you really did bring her to life in a way that is unmatched. So I'll just say it.
Thank you. Thank you. That's just like the sweetest thing ever to hear. That's like the, and when people say, you know, when I read the comics, I hear you in my head, you know, like there's, you know, that and being told you're part of somebody's childhood,
yeah,
doesn't get much better than that. You know, it's really something else. You know, I think that for the seven of us, we never take that for granted on the Justice League because we've been told it so many times by the fans. And I think I've been, you know, arguing for a reunion for 10 years because we're at the front lines at these cons meeting the fans. We're the ones that are having the conversations about how much the show meant to them, how they ran home from school, how it got them through a difficult time, through bullying or domestic issues at their house or whatever. And it was comforting to come home and see those characters and to see them win, you know, to see them win, to have good triumph over evil. You know, we need to see that, especially now, frankly.
Especially.
And, you know, it's humbling. I mean, it's humbling to be a part of something like that. And if I thought that like, wow, well, we kind of did tell all the stories and we don't really have any new stories left to tell. Okay, that's one thing, but there's so many wonderful stories. And again, so many, a whole new generation of storytellers. And I think that there's a lot, you know, left out there to explore.
Like, I know like the lady that voiced Wonder Woman for the Super Friends stuff got like
Shannon?
Yeah, she got stalkers. Did you get stalkers out of this too? Like, were you pretty much left alone as far as that stuff was concerned?
What do you mean stalkers?
She got people who like camp out at her house, like in front of her house and stuff.
Oh God, no. Nothing like that. No, I mean, I think that, you know, I have had immense good fortune with the people that I've met at cons on Twitter who follow Wonder Woman. I, you know, even though I've gotten rather political lately, because I just think our lives are so political and I don't think we have the luxury of not being political right now. So if I've lost a few people along the way because they disagree with that, then that's okay.
Yeah.
But you know, the Wonder Woman people, the Justice League people, they've been the loveliest. I mean, I haven't had any, you know, once in a while you get a bad egg and somebody's rude.
Right.
I don't partake in that. I don't have conversations with that. I don't have time for that. Life is too short. And I try to conjure up my Diana and just, you know, be kind and be compassionate and then move on. It's like, I try to channel her.
And I think I kind of want to bring that up too, because you just touched on something that, which is one of the main reasons. So I kind of got into comics in a weird way. Like, I grew up kind of on the poor side. We lived in this duplex. On the other side of the duplex was this older guy who had a box of comics that he was going to give away. He just gave it to me instead. And I kind of regret, I probably sold them at some point or gave them away at some point. And there probably was some really valuable early issues in there, but point being that the thing that, you know, there was like Spider-Man, Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, Green Lantern, all those comics were in there.
And
I was pretty young. And the thing that got me into Wonder Woman, I mean, the TV show was a big part of it too. I used to watch it with my dad. I was a little kid, so I watched it for a much different reason than my dad did. I realized after puberty, like, that was like, oh, okay, yeah, the slow motion Linda Carter running is why you watched it. I watched it because of superheroes. Yeah. But the thing I loved about Wonder Woman is, like, a lot of superhero stories are always baked in tragedy. You know, Batman lost his parents, Superman's planet, he lost his parents, it blew up. You know, it's usually someone dying, it's someone, something tragic in that person's life that brings them to that call of justice. And with Wonder Woman, it's just really this call of duty, you know, like, and like, it's a positive thing. It's not like, hey, I lost my family, so I want to go do this. It's like, I want to go do good in the world because I can help, you know? And like, there is that sort of, you know, justice to it in a way that's a little bit more positive, I think, than a lot of other superheroes.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, her leaving the mascara was tinged with some sadness, just because she loved her sisters and loved her mother. Right. But yeah, you're right. I mean, it was just a sense of duty and, you know, there was a mission there and she is trying to make the world a better place. And it's funny because when we talk about compassion and her goodness in the Justice League, you know, she's short tempered. It made me laugh because she would like have like no patience in certain situations. And I'm like, seriously? They almost made her so human, you know, yeah. You know, beat up on people and have to be pulled back a little bit. And that was just fun. You know, that was like fun because it was another element to her, which I love.
Well, and I love that too, because I think what they did really well on that, and that, I mean, the show is just so good. So anyone watching, please go binge watch that. You'll just love it. But I think the thing that they did really well with her is they really did kind of bring in that princess element to her. You know, she kind of was a little hoity-toity and kind of had her nose up in the air just a little bit towards things. And I think that was smart. I mean, you saw her soften over the years, but yeah. I thought it was really smart when they pulled her off the island that it was like, she's royalty. And of course, she's going to react that way as royalty in certain situations because she doesn't understand what us regular folk do. You know, it was a really brilliant storytelling, I thought.
Yeah, that's really true. I mean, because all of a sudden, you know, she's sharing the stage with these other people and doesn't know their ways. I mean, I think that's why, you know, one of her sweetest dynamics on the show was with Jean because they were both outsiders. And yeah. Carl Lumley can just break your heart reading anything. And he's just the loveliest, loveliest actor I think I've ever worked with. And, you know, so he just dropped that immediately. And, you know, it was just always sweet. I always loved our scenes together because there was that sense of being separated from people who, and being in a place where you're not quite understood and missing home. Yeah. And I loved that aspect of our dynamic. It was always a joy to play that.
One of the best things I think from that show too is the way that they brought Steve Trevor into that universe. I love how they sent her back in time and they had, you know, they honored that relationship and it was just really charming. And you know, that part where she goes to visit him when he's older, like it's just like, oh, crushing. It's just so crushing, you know?
So touching, my God, my God. And of course, Patrick Duffy was there and he was in the recording studio with me. And I grew up, again, hello, soap operas. So I was a huge Dallas fan, huge, especially the early years. Just sitting across from Bobby Ewing, who was my Steve Trevor, chills. I mean, even now I can feel it. You know, it's just, that's what I'm saying about those sessions. We were all together at Warner Brothers in this huge room, you know, like maybe 14 mics all around and everyone was in there. We would do a read through, you know, a rehearsal and everyone was there. Just a bunch of actors sitting in, you know, in a room reading through these scripts. And staring across. I mean, I love Steve Trevor. I loved Patrick as Steve. You know, those scenes with them, I thought were delicious.
So, you know, Wonder Woman's had involvement with Superman, Batman a little bit in the Justice League animation. Steve Trevor, who's your favorite Wonder Woman boyfriend to date out of those? Who do you think is the best match for her?
Well, you know what? I don't really think of it in terms of boyfriend because that just feels so traditional and human. So, like, I don't really think like I don't see her with a boyfriend. I don't see her with a husband. You know, for me, Batman and that, you know, that relationship that was hinted at in the series was amazing. Because it was just fun to play. And Kevin Conroy, Batman and I think our voices have a certain thing. I don't know what it is, but there's a chemistry there with our voices and the way they were written and that kiss and, you know, this little piggy episode, which I always refer to as one of my favorites because it was just delightful. It was just delightful. And it gave us an opportunity to play something a little bit more frivolous, a little bit, lighter. And, you know, it just rounded out our characters because it gave them another aspect. It gave them romance to play. And I know what he, you know, I know that he knows that he knows, you know, and I love that. Right. Wink, wink. So that was just yummy. And, you know, I've gone on record as saying that I love Wonderbat, hashtag Wonderbat. Having said that, I love Steve Trevor. Superman, no. Superman is like my brother, and I will never, ever, ever see them as a romantic couple.
It's kind of boring to have them. I mean, they're so super powered and stuff. I think that, like, with Batman, I like the sort of, he's kind of dark, and he, you know, clearly has these sort of issues, and she kind of is the light side. You know, I think there's a good,
yes,
like, you know, yin-yang there.
Yes, I agree. And also, Superman, to me, how I grew up with Christopher Reeve and Margot Kidder, like it was Superman and Lois. Like they were the couple. I don't really need Wonder Woman to have a boyfriend or a husband, certainly, or children, or like, I don't need any of that. I need her to be the woman she is. And as a woman, there's going to be a sexuality to her and whatever that preference is, whether it's the bisexual Wonder Woman or the heterosexual Wonder Woman, like I don't care,
right.
But I just think it's nice to have her play that. And as an actor, it's great to be able to play those scenes because it's part of us. It's part of who we are. It's part of who she is and Bruce,
yeah.
You know, and Steve. But the stuff with Steve was really those scenes were just magical, you know,
yeah.
And just, you know, the way he would talk to me and, you know, it's just lovely, lovely.
Yeah. Just great,
I think
great
that
point.
Great stuff and the fact that they got Patrick and it was just all wonderful. I think one of the arguments to Batman is that they know each other's worlds. And I think there's a lot to be said for that. They understand the missions. They understand the responsibility.
Yeah.
And Batman's always going to be an outsider. So he's never going to commit to anything. And that the truth is that's okay, I think, with Wonder Woman, because she's right. Not looking for a ring.
Well, she's going to outlive him anyway, too. That's the other part of it, you know.
100%. So I think as long as there's fun and flirty and, you know, that was some of my favorite stuff to play because it gave me, Susan, the chance to do that. And I loved it.
You mentioned that, you know, you've lost some people from being a little bit more political. And I agree with you. I mean, to me, food is 100% political. There's no getting around it. You have to eat. And how we grow our food, how we treat our water, how we treat the land, what pesticides we use, what farm worker mm-hmm. rights there are, what energy we use. Do you have access to good food? Are you in a food desert? All those things make food political and you have to do it every single day. You have no choice. And so like when people tell me like, shut up and cook, you know, versus being political, I'm like, if you don't understand that food is political, that's a point of privilege, right? That's like coming from that privilege point. And you kind of talk to, you know, and I've had the same thing where I've lost some people from being political, but you know, you also gain some people too, as a result of it. And I wonder like, what, when you kind of decided to make that decision to be a little bit more political, because you think that that's where we need to be, like, what was that like for you? Like, was it just sort of like you kind of hit that tipping point, or was it sort of gradual, or have you always been a little political, but maybe just not publicly?
You know, I've always been political because I come from a political minded family. You know, my parents were big, they were voters, and they took it seriously. And I remember as a young girl, like waiting for my parents to get home after they voted, you know, in the different races where I grew up in Rhode Island. So it's always mattered to me. It's always felt like an obligation as a citizen to be a part of it and to understand what's happening in the world. I think when you are on Twitter or social media and you're known as one thing, and that's Wonder Woman, you know, there's a, for me, there was this sense of responsibility to her. you know, to Diana. I'm aware that people associate me with her, and so I want to conduct myself in a certain way. And I don't want to tarnish her in any way. At the same time, I'm also Susan Eisenberg, and I have to live my life, and I have to live in this country, and I have to speak my mind. It's just a part of my personality, and it's how I was raised. And so, you know, you make choices, and I try to make smart choices every day with what I put out there and what I engage in. And sometimes I, you know, misstep, and that's okay. We all do. Right. But I just can't not say anything. That would feel like a lie, you know, to not say anything. And it would make me feel bad. And so I feel it's my obligation to say things, and not because I'm going to change this one or that one's opinion, but because I just need to put my own truth out into the world. And right. If people want to engage with me on it, fantastic. If people are swayed by it, fantastic. If people want to argue my truth, you know, I don't really need to argue my truth with somebody. So that there's that. But I think that I love what you said about food. I love, you know, I think Michelle Obama, when she was first lady, talked so much about that and where we live, and are we, like, the income inequality to food, and that people who have money take it for granted that they have access to the good vegetables and the farmers markets and the healthy living, and how that's a luxury. That is an absolute luxury. So I love what you said about it. I love that you see it as political. And for me, because I am such an animal lover, you know, I just, the notion that animals are used and killed, and not only that, but treated so horrifically, horrifically in this country and in the world, you know, I have to speak out about that because they are powerless to do it themselves. That I will often think about those tweets. Because, you know, you think, is this going to change anyone's mind? Is this going to change the system? Is this, what will this do if I put this out there where a pig is being slaughtered, or you see the birds in the cages? I can't look away. Now, do I share it necessarily? Sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. But I look because I feel the obligation to look and see what's there. I'm not vegan. I'm a vegetarian.
I'm vegetarian too. Yay, I didn't know that about you.
So I'm vegetarian. I've been a vegetarian for a very, very long time, probably 25 years.
Nice.
At the same time, like, I feel like I'm on the cusp because of how I do feel about animals and their safety and their rights to live the lives they are entitled to and the freedom that they're entitled to. It has made me veer toward veganism, but I haven't been able to make that final leap. I just haven't.
Yeah.
And I see that in my future, but I'm just not there yet.
I feel the same. I mean, there's, you know, like, they're starting to, like, I just actually am working with this one product. In fact, I think they're launching today. It's called Zero Egg, and it's a plant-based egg replacer. And they have, like, two products, one for, like, where the egg is the star of the dish, like, say you're making a quiche, and one for, like, baking with, but it's all plant-based. And they sent me, like, a egg McMuffin type thing with it. And it was so delicious. And I was like, I would easily eat this instead of regular eggs. And because, you know, it is true. Like, the cruelty around even just, and I try to buy the cage free and get good eggs and all that kind of stuff. But the cruelty is that, you know, a lot of male chicks are just thrown into a grinder when they're born because the females are the ones that they want. You know, we want to produce eggs and all that kind of stuff. And so being, you know, knowing those things, and like, I too am trying to get closer to, I mean, I don't know if I'll ever be fully vegan, but I, right now I'd say I eat about half and half. So like, I, you know, I try to be close to vegan as much as possible, but you know, there's just times when I really want cheese.
I hear you.
Give it to me.
I know. And I'm sure there are vegans out there saying, okay, we've got you covered with the cheeses. Right. But yeah, no, because that's like one of my big things is the cheese. Because, you know, I don't, you know, I switched to from milk a long time ago in terms of like, you know, I use almond milk and things like that. So that's not, but the cheeses are a little tricky. I got to be honest. I love my cheeses. And yet, when I go to eat a piece of cheese, there's that voice now that says, okay, do you know where this came from?
Yeah.
You know, if if the animals were treated humanely, because that matters to me so much.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm a work in progress with this stuff, but I, you know, as much as I want to speak out about the politics, I also like to, I feel I need to speak out with about animals. And, you know, I just, even silly things like, you know, the dog, the funny dog videos and all that, just because I think we need to smile more. And animals, I think, are so much better than we are. I think we are so disappointing as a species. I really do. I really do.
They're much, much more unconditional in their love and everything else. So I always like to do a recipe sort of inspired by interviews. And I still have a few more questions for you. But since we're talking about food, my original thought was to maybe do a cocktail because I have this Wonder Woman glass I could do a cocktail in. Or I could do a food recipe. Is there anything you sort of lean towards? Like, what kind of things do you like to eat as far as, or drink? You know, what are some of your favorites?
Well, I like a good cocktail. And I, you know, I love Mexican food. I love quiches. I love pasta. I'm not a foodie and I'm really basic, you know, like I have three older sisters. They can all cook. And my mother was a wonderful cook. She didn't like cooking, but she was very good at it. And I don't have that gene. It's like, I have friends who get so excited. I'll cut out, my friend Rachel, she just gets so excited with recipes. So I'll cut things out for her. And I'm like, I like this. And she's like, I'll make it for you. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm so lucky. There's no part of me that sits there and says, okay, so what do I need to get the store? No part of me that wants to go get the ingredients and bring it home and then cook it up. I'm telling you. But you know, I love salads. I mean, I'm not a foodie. Definitely not a foodie.
So
I'm not.
Like, do you like spicy flavor profiles? Any sort of like herbs or pick, like, you know?
Love herbs. I like spice, but not too spicy, medium spicy. I don't like mushrooms, but if you cook something with that's vegetarian, chances are I'm going to dig it because I just love vegetarian cooking. Yeah. In fact, I'm looking for a service right now for, you know, vegetarian meal delivery.
Oh,
if you know of one that is like really great,
I probably
you know, that's prepared.
Yeah. I'll look into that. I know of a few. I mean, I cook so much that I obviously don't use them, but I probably know of a few. In fact, the whole time you're kind of talking there, I'm just when this pandemic is over, I just want to come down and hang out and cook and watch like some Justice League with you. You know, like, is it, so I know some actors have a hard time like watching themselves on screen. Is it hard for you to listen to yourself in a voice acting scenario? Like, can you watch that stuff and like still appreciate it? Like, you know, like when I watch my cooking videos, I'm kind of just cringe a little bit, you know?
Well, but you know, the cooking videos, it's you. And you know, with me, it's just, it's my voice. I don't like being on camera, which is why I went into voiceover. So, you know, Zoom calls and all this other stuff is challenging, but sometimes it can be awkward if you just, you listen to it and you're like, really, what were you thinking? But when I listen to the beginning of Justice League, what I hear when I listen to it is my nerves. You know, I was nervous and that it took me a while to find her voice because it was so intimidating being in that room with all these big actors and in some cases celebrities. And I just didn't feel I belonged in that room. So it took me a long time to feel like I've got this. I can do this. I was always giddy about going because it just never felt real that that was my life, that I got to go to Warner Brothers and record in this room with other people and give voice to this extraordinary character. It always felt surreal to me that I got to do that. But yeah, I mean, there are definitely episodes I listen to and go, yeesh. But you know, sometimes I listen to it and I'm like, okay, pretty good. Yeah, pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's I don't cringe like I would with on camera.
So I probably know this answer, but who would Wonder Woman vote for?
Well, she's, stands for, you know, truth and justice, equality.
I can even make it a little harder. Who would she vote for in the primary? Let's maybe like, we'll like put it that way so you have more options to pick from.
You know what, but that's to me, so I'm not going to say who she would vote for.
Okay.
Because that to me does feel like politicizing that character that I don't own. I can say who I'd vote for.
Okay.
And I have, you know, like, listen, I mean, hashtag, you know, I'm excited for the election. I can't wait for this to be over. and to have new leaders. Like, it's time. Let's turn the effing page on this chapter of our history. And it's not just about turning a page. I'm excited for the new page. You know, like Biden and Harris, I dig them both. You know, I think choosing Harris was the smartest thing Joe Biden could have done.
Yeah.
You know, she brings so much to the ticket. So, I mean, I wanted Elizabeth Warren.
Same. I was Team Warren all the way.
Team Warren. You know, I don't think there's anybody smarter or, you know, she's just good and smart. Listen, I'm such a sucker for smart. I mean, beauty is beauty and it's wonderful. But man, if you're smart and I can learn something from you, I'm all in. And she's just the smartest person in the room.
Yeah.
But what I do love about Harris is that she's so smart and she's beyond charismatic, you know, and I love that. I love that. I love that she's feisty and she's strong and I'm excited. And you know what? I know that Elizabeth Warren will be in the cabinet. It's all good. It's all good.
I would say the one thing that these past like 3.5 years under Trump have made me wish was real is I wish we had the lasso of truth. Like, you know, it's just, I just wish that was a real thing. So, you know, there's just so much lie and misinformation. I'm with you. I very much look forward to this election and hopefully a good result from this election.
Oh man, from your mouth. And you know, the thing is, like, when people engage with the shame and how could he, it's like he doesn't concern, you know, except for the safety of our country and our citizens, his it doesn't concern me anymore. You know, it's like I'm always stunned that people have expectations that people are going to do the right thing. Some people are just, you know, they don't have that drive, they don't have that compass. And, you know, we just have to focus on our road and, you know, stay focused on it. And, you know, let's just make this happen.
100%. I have one last question and I'll totally understand if you aren't up for it, but can you give us a little Wonder Woman line or voice? Is that something that you can do on the spot or?
Sure.
Okay.
Okay. So you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Superman, meet me at the Watchtower. I'll be there in 20 minutes. Don't tell Hawkgirl.
Love it. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking time to talk to me today. I'm glad that we finally made it happen. I hope when all this is over at some point, we can hang out in real life and enjoy a cocktail or a meal or, you know, cook something vegetarian. I can just sit there and cook and you can just read the recipe as Wonder Woman and it'll be great.
Oh my gosh, that's adorable. That's adorable. And you're on. I will do it. Thank you. Thank you for being so persistent and being so kind and supportive. You've always been lovely. So thank you so much for hosting me.
Yeah, of course. And I will be retweeting those GL reunion hashtags. I'll be on the lookout for those. And I'll let you know what recipe I come up with. And when the interview is going to come out, I'll send it over to you.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
Awesome.
Have a great day.
Yes, you too. Take care. Stay safe out there.
Okay, bye-bye.
How wonderful is Susan, right? She's so much fun to talk to. And I just love the fact that she gave us that Wonder Woman voice at the end was amazing. Plus, she's a fellow vegetarian. So, you know, just like me. Thank you for tuning in. Susan, thank you so much for taking your time to like talk with me and hang out. I hope you liked the recipe that I did. If you're curious what I'm talking about, I did a cocktail inspired by Wonder Woman. It's a Wonder Woman piña colada, so be sure to go check out that recipe in that video. I'll see you guys next time.